In 1898, W.E.B. Du Bois wrote The Philadelphia Negro, the first comprehensive documentation of the health and social conditions experienced by blacks in Philadelphia. In it, Du Bois rejected the widely held assumptions of inherent racial differences. He argued that poor health status of blacks was not solely individually determined, but largely influenced by community, environmental, and institutional factors, including racism, that adversely impacted communities of color. This film series presents a variety of perspectives on the health status of racial and ethnic minorities in Michigan. It is intended to provide information from current research as well as experiences and opinions from a diverse group of Michigan residents. We hope this series will do much to raise awareness of the multiple factors that impact health for racial and ethnic minorities in Michigan. Our goal is that the community-based solutions presented in this series and the recognition of work being done in communities and organizations provide an impetus for moving Michigan toward full equity.
A fair, just distribution of the opportunities and resources needed to attain well-being. What that means is that you need a level playing field in the areas of education, of housing, transportation, all the social determinants of health. People need to have the same opportunity for that, to have those things that actually are connected to physical health and emotional health and mental health.
They're so accustomed, or they've gotten so used to, say for instance, not having adequate transportation in their community that they don't see that as a deterrent to good health. And so part of our charge is really to help create that awareness or increase that level of literacies so that they see those environmental changes and some of the other social determinants of health to be a pathway to better health.
Social determinants of health are the social, economic, and environmental conditions that influence people's health. For example, transportation, housing, income, employment, and stress are all social determinants of health.
What we mean by health disparities are when there are big differences in health status or in the use of health care that are unfair to disadvantaged groups and that are avoidable. If one population can achieve high level of health status, then another group should be able to do the same. And what we have to ask is, why aren't those groups with poorer health doing as well as the wealthier group?
Because of historical discrimination and structural racism, people of color are likely to be less wealthy, to have less education, and to live in segregated communities with underfunded schools, insufficient services, poor transportation and housing, and higher levels of exposure to toxic and environmental hazards.
There are these differences in health outcomes across a variety of populations, particularly those populations that are of color, have less education, have had maybe a historical legacy of discrimination and racism, and they tend to have different, more clearly worse health outcomes than the general population.
Racial patterns of health and disease have little, if anything, to do with genes. Instead, they reflect patterns of social and economic inequity based on socially constructed ideas about race. To put it another way, race doesn't cause illness. Racism does.
I believe that it absolutely impacts, and if anything is trickling down in this society today, it is racism that's trickling down. And yet it was happening anyway, and there was not a lot anybody could do about it. And the acceptance of that has been a burden that I've carried with me throughout my life. I have an issue with accepting. People keep telling me you need to accept what it is. Well, I accept what it is. It's injustice. But how do you accept injustice without trying to change it?
Whether overt discrimination or structural disadvantage, racism continues to influence how people are treated, what resources and jobs are available.
The reality is that there are a lot of non-health related things that directly affect health. So a lot of the policies and practices that we have around trying to increase educational opportunities, access to jobs and job training and so forth will also have a major effect on health.
What we are recognizing is that it's not good enough to just review policies and change policies. Because one, policies are constructed by individuals, and policies are interpreted and applied by individuals. So if you have a wonderful policy, but people individually that possess biases and stereotypes are implementing them, then the problem persists.
In spite of the operation of the National Health Service and everyone having universal access to health care, the health of the population was probably better off overall, but the differences were still there, and that's because of what we've been talking about before, the conditions of life associated with different socioeconomic conditions were not changed dramatically by the National Health Service. They're not going to be changed dramatically by healthcare reform here. So the problem of health disparities is a much bigger problem than a problem of healthcare reform. And in fact, you could make an argument that we would actually get much further or faster on healthcare disparities by investing in education for people than we're going to get from investing in healthcare.
And so once we go into this, realize that there's no one silver bullet and one solution, then we'll be ahead of the game. But as long as we think that we change public policy, it's going to fix the problem, then we're going to always be behind it, because that's not the only answer.
Just as a social determinants approach to improve health equity must involve health care, so must programs to control priority public conditions include attention to the social determinants of health. Such action has to involve multiple sectors in addition to the health care sector. It is not sufficient, for example, to provide treatment for people with diabetes in middle-income countries and not deal with the drivers of the obesity epidemic, to be concerned with childhood illness and not education of women who will become mothers, to deliver health education to individuals and not be concerned with their poverty, to deal with stress-related illness and ignore conditions in which people live and work that gave rise to it.
Fruits and vegetables provide a lot of health benefits. For example, they give a fiber, which is an important part of health, but they contain a lot of vitamins and minerals and other nutritive substances that help to prevent disease or treat disease. But as a basic recommendation, 5 servings of fruits and vegetables a day is important. Most people do not get that much, they get significantly less.
Fewer people are eating fresh fruits and vegetables, which in Michigan can be really difficult to access.
Race-based residential segregation is a major factor in the sense that it can influence where people live, how they live, the resources in those environments.
Particularly minorities are often low income and don't have access to healthy food because they don't have money to purchase them.
Families don't have enough money to buy good ingredients for a good meal.
Or they live in communities that don't offer healthy foods in the stores that are available.
The interesting part is that when you look at, as an example, the Southwest side, and you look on the east side in the African-American community is much more devastated by the lack of available fresh fruits and vegetables, fresh products, period. If you don't have a safe place to walk around in, to exercise in, if there are no facilities to exercise, if there are no stores that have fresh fruits and vegetables.
And whether or not people have opportunity to engage in healthy behaviors, such as it's hard to eat healthy food if you don't have actually access to healthy food. But can also be, you know, certain social environments can actually influence people's health and health behavior as well.
You know, those are all determinants of what a community will not be able to do.
A food desert is a district with little or no access to foods needed to maintain a healthy diet. These districts often have high concentrations of fast food restaurants and convenience stores, but no grocery stores or places to buy fresh fruits and vegetables.
Availability
You know, it has to be available. It has to be there for people to use it.
There are food deserts in Garfield Park, Sika, and Mana because there weren't actual grocery stores within that area.
Folks do not have access to what we would call it a viable grocery store.
I mean, just a store. There are no major food stores, food chains in the city of Detroit. None.
Race-based segregation refers to the physical separation of the races in residential contexts. It was imposed by legislation, supported by economic institutions, enshrined in housing policy, and enforced by the judicial system. In both northern and southern cities, levels of black-white segregation increased dramatically from 1860 to 1940 and have remained strikingly stable since then.
Public health is not just about the choices people make. You know, a lot of our efforts are trying to make healthy choices, the easy choices, right? Right now, a lot of times the easy choices are the McDonald's down the corner, it's cheap, it's available, it's easy, you go in and out fast.
From the time we rode from Gratiot and 8 Mile all the way to downtown the city of Detroit, not one healthy food store, not a health food store. We rode past a number of McDonald's, a number of Church's Chickens, Popeye's Chicken.
You have larger portions of meals that are eaten outside of the home that happen to have more nutrition issues.
Lack of access to nutritious foods leads to chronic health issues.
Weight and obesity, we look at physical activity, we look at drinking. Lower socioeconomic people are the risky ones. But it's not just then though people will say, well, that means it's all those individuals' fault in some sense. They could choose to do it differently. Well, it's not quite that easy, you know, to choose to do it differently.
Well, we have issues of health literacy, inadequate health literacy in populations, and those will go into a family environment, into a community, and impact access to food, jobs, housing.
Unemployment factors, poverty, is a major cause of obesity and unhealthy diet. So that is a very important part of the obesity status.
And there has been an increase over time in the amount of overweight and obese individuals throughout Michigan. We're looking at as much as 2/3 of the population who are considered overweight or obese.
If we can improve the health of the population, we could reduce some of the need and demand for health care.
It's not just about health care, it's about the environment, it's about the community, and making sure that that is healthy, and then that will allow us to better address health disparities.
And we're going to end up with a healthier population.
What is being done to increase healthy food availability?
I think that needs to be done is that the policies have to address those basic preventative health care issues for everybody.
Support the capacity of communities to have healthy food environments. And I think one of the things that's happening in Detroit as well as nationally now is there's some tremendously exciting initiatives that are unfolding, really trying to address this issue of food and food access.
The answer isn't just in supermarkets, large chains, but that it's really wanting to support local businesses.
That also builds jobs within the city, that allows people to have access to a living wage, that allows people to gain access to other factors that we know are very much associated not only to what people eat, but their access to the resources more broadly to have a healthy lifestyle.
This is my garden. I grow peppers and tomatoes and watermelons and squash and cucumbers and different things like that. These are some of the vegetables that I grow that I picked out of my garden earlier this week.
Different nonprofit groups who are working with business developers view food as a conduit to economic development.
Because just like this garden exists, we've been able to identify, just walking around the neighborhood, at a minimum, 30, 35 food gardens that exist.
I grow all of them organic myself. Most of my vegetables are grown from seeds. It helps me save at the market. As far as prices, I don't have to buy in the summer months.
There's quite a bit of food growing happening in the community, so we think that maybe we need to switch our thinking a little bit around
in terms of access to healthy food.
I think that it's important to remember that sometimes, although you really want to shoot for the stars, sometimes you have to do that incrementally. And the farmers market in Ypsilanti, as well as our project Healthy Start programs in and about Washtenaw County, have been very successful.
So if we can figure out how do we build social capital, social networking, connect people with, you know, not only selling their food through a farmer's market. There's not a local farmer's market in this community. It would be nice if there was one. But also on some level, how to share food.
I usually share them with my neighbors and family and friends. They come over, they ask, could they have tomatoes, you know.
When they think about why should we invest in education? Why should we invest in urban housing policies to improve the residential environments of people? It's not only because those are, quote, good things to have for people in and of themselves, but it's also because those are things that actually are going to make people healthier.
Unless access to healthy food greatly improves, residents will continue to have greater rates of premature illness and death from diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, cancer, hypertension, obesity, and kidney failure, leaving its mark directly on the quality, productivity, and length of life, and indirectly on healthcare costs, school test scores, and the economic vitality of the city and the state. Identifying solutions that promote access to nutritious and healthy food choices will require input and support from residents, as well as from grocers, developers, health advocates, educators, government, and foundations. Our ability to manage the pressures that might upset our lives is not simply a matter of personality or character. It's tied to our access to power, resources, support networks, and opportunities. Both exposures to stressors and access to the resources we need to manage them are tied to our class and social status.
The more that you are unable to, you know, reasonably often and easily get into a kind of comfortable relationship with your environment, the more that you are challenged, and your body is challenged both physically and psychologically all the time.
There have been studies that have shown that stress can be good and stress can be bad.
Well, we certainly know that stress, sort of even at a physiological level, really has an impact on health.
And that creates, you know, it converts to chronic problems. It also just creates a kind of wear and tear on the body and system over time.
Past number of years is how directly stress can kind of get inside the body or under the skin, as they say, and just really have an impact on physical health, mental health.
Intensive prolonged stress can lead to a variety of short and long-term negative health effects.
So if you think about low-income Black people living in the inner city or Native Americans living on a reservation, they're exposed to a great variety of stresses, and that would be things like the kinds of housing they live in, the kinds of neighborhoods they might live in, the kinds of jobs they may have or they might not have jobs at all, issues like discrimination and racism, the kind of nutrition that they have available to them.
Because if you don't have enough money, you can't buy the foods that you need for your household, you're also under stress worrying about it.
All of these stressors over a lifetime take a big toll on people's health.
So you know, it's almost like a cycle that really has to be broken.
You know, everybody handles their stress differently, and it impacts the health differently.
Smoking and other kinds of things are ways that people cope with stress, and these people are under a lot more stress. They also have less good social networks and support relationships on the whole. They're more likely to have, you know, stressful environments and dangers, which creates psychological anxiety, tension, and so forth that contributes to health problems.
reality is that there are a lot of non-health related things that directly affect health.
And you're consistently exposed to environmental toxins, your housing sub-quality, the schools are no good. You basically have, you know, 2.5 strikes against you before you even start out. So when you get cancer or you get heart disease when you're 50, it's not because you didn't get medical care when you were 45, it's because you lived a whole life of deprivation. And I think that's really where these inequalities start.
So for African American men, they may cope with stress in more unhealthy ways because they're under more stress because of the lack of economic opportunities, lack of social resources, lack of other kinds of economic resources that are available in their communities.
So all of those things are determining health, and all of those things are being, your exposure to them is being determined in some degree by your socioeconomic position or your race and ethnicity.
People who are lower on the socioeconomic pyramid tend to be exposed to more formidable and ongoing stressors, job security, unpaid bills, inadequate childcare, underperforming schools, and dangerous living conditions.
One of the reasons that poverty can really affect child development is through sort of family stress and parent stress. And parents are more stressed out, they transmit that to the kids. And
things like exposure to violence or exposure to violence of a family member that really puts continued stress on the body and reduces the immune system for both pregnant women as well as infants. It can, in children, can cause a reduction in brain development if it happens during the early years.
Childhood stress can lead to health problems later in life, including alcoholism, depression, eating disorders, heart disease, cancer, and other chronic diseases.
Motherly intercession. We serve children of incarcerated parents, and our mission is to break the cycle of intergenerational incarceration.
My daughter had been incarcerated in December. She's now down in the Huron Valley Women's Correctional Facility in prison down there. So I ended up with my 3 grandchildren taking care of them. It's hard too because I didn't think I had to raise any more kids. But, you know, I hate to see that they don't have any parents. It's been very tough on them. They have not been able to see their mother since the middle of April.
Parental incarceration creates additional challenges for children and families, often resulting in school behavior and performance problems, shame, social and institutional stigma, financial instability, with a disparate impact on families of color.
And the kids' actual way of regulating their stress, if they're in a situation where they need to calm themselves down, they may not be physically able to do that because their physiology has really been changed and they're just secreting stress hormones more often, and that can really have a great impact on your general health.
It's the same thing in a physical sense. If you're playing hard and doing sports, you're running, you're doing something like that. Everybody, we can all do that for some period of time, but if you can't get away from that, if people are pushed to run too far, too long, in too hot an environment, they collapse and they have problems.
If the children's stress mechanisms, if their diet, if their education was really taken care of for the first 5 to 10 years, I think we would have a very, very different manifestation of disease in our populations, in our towns. What is the best leverage point? Where could you do the most good for the least amount of money? We could make a difference, but it would have to be through the simultaneous working of grassroots.
And have places for people to go so they can sit and talk and relieve some of the stress that they're having.
Working with communities to help each other to see what they can do to make their health a little bit better in their circumstances.
Once the people step out and talk, voice their opinions, write letters to your senator and get to Congress. And
then you get some other people at the political sort of high decision making.
Because those are the people who can make the changes. But until we stand up and talk to these people, stop being afraid, because they're there to serve us.
And actually make the right choices about who gets what resources.
Then we can get some service done.
People need to feel safe, protected, and respected. And I don't think that people feel respected, therefore they don't respect.
Social policies like living wage jobs, greater autonomy and control at work, safe, walkable neighborhoods, efficient public transportation, good schools and quality affordable housing, and paid vacations are all effective ways to reduce stress, though they require a political commitment, not just a personal one.
There are some major barriers to healthcare. The makeup of patients across the country are continuously changing, and therefore our challenges are always continuously changing.
If we remember our history very well, you know, the legacy of the South, you know, with, you know, slavery and, you know, Jim Crowism and the issue of race and race relations have really played an integral part, I think, in how African Americans, you know, choose to interface with modern day healthcare, or how they choose to, you know, integrate with the healthcare delivery system.
Minorities may experience a range of other barriers to accessing care, even when insured at the same level as whites, including barriers of language, geography, and culture familiarity.
And here is the scenario. You have an, let's say, an African-American man whose age is 50 years old, who has insurance, has a good job, and lives in a good community with a family. And you have a white man who also has, who's 50 years old, has the same family, same health insurance card, same job, same everything. And you follow them both into the health system when they have, let's say, a heart attack. What the disparities in healthcare have shown is that these two people get treated on average very differently. And the differences are that the black person tends to get less intensive treatment, less quality of care, and might have a less positive outcome than the white patient. And people ask the question, well, is this racism on the part of doctors? Are they overtly discriminating against blacks? And I think the answer is no. It's much more insidious than that. Is that there are certain unconscious stereotypes that physicians have, and by the way, all of us have, so that when they meet an African-American patient, without even thinking about it, they're trying to think about what is the likelihood that this person will have a good outcome, might not have a good family life, that he might not be able to follow the recommendations of the physician, might not be able to rehabilitate. They might decide not to do a procedure like.
And culturally, yeah, it's they're not treated with respect because of their race a lot of times. So they have an added, not only do they have that basic problem of even accessing the health care, maybe they're on Medicare and it's this, you know, prejudice, oh yeah, you know, Native, or whether it's African American or Native.
The health system is less responsive to black patients than to white patients. The same is true for low versus high income patients.
And it's amazing what the hoops you have to jump through and the time frames that have to be that you have to wait in order to get therapy, rehabilitation, certain services, just to get into hospitals. People that don't know and are not in these fields and don't understand how it works walk away.
The first thing is it's the language barrier, the cultural differences, and economics. I mean, most people, I mean, if you don't have jobs, you don't have insurance. So if you're uninsured, you hardly would go to the doctor and have you get your healthcare needs.
So each tribe usually has a clinic or a, you know, a behavioral health department, they have one. But, you know, for the urban natives, they have just this one clinic, and it's providing service for, you know, 30,000 natives. So a big issue that the clinic runs into is, you know, understaffed and underfunding to provide that service for such a large amount of people spread over a large area.
Access is the attainment of timely, sufficient, and appropriate health care of adequate quality such that health outcomes are maximized.
Most of this center don't have
they lack interpreters, and most of these Asian, especially other Asians like the Vietnamese, the Chinese, they really hardly speak English. And we need these navigators or any interpreter to help them out and to explain them. They can trust, even with the navigators, they have the same language, they can trust through the interpreter. That helps a lot.
Many people who are coming to healthcare system, they find it very hard to navigate, not speaking the language, not understanding their treatment plans, or not understanding the way they need to take their medications.
Because there was a fear of coming to a place where the providers did not speak their language, did not understand their culture. The area of Pontiac has recently been growing in Spanish-speaking populations, and we were not prepared for that in this area.
A patient's preferred language is the language he or she prefers to receive medical care and health information. Someone's preferred language may be different from his or her primary language.
This is a cultural thing, and also hesitant. They're very hesitant to go because they think they will not be understood by the doctor what their needs, and again, because of their language, because of the language barrier.
So if I speak English and you speak Spanish, we're going to need some assistance in working out the communication between the two of us, and that is critically important.
We have presented with challenges, and especially with Hispanic and Arabic communities that required language services, language help. Language barriers are a big issue in healthcare these days. What happened over the last 5 years, we grew exponentially, and our services are multiple now, and they're targeted. We have a set of bilingual staff. They're trained to help in medical interpreting. We have on-site Arabic and Spanish speaking staff. They're medical interpreters. We have a phone system. Basically, this is an over-the-phone interpreting process. And what this does is a dual handset system that can connect the provider on one side, the patient on the other side, and the interpreter on the third side. So you have a three-way communication between the provider, the nurse, and the patient, and the interpreter.
When we can't speak to them, all we can do then is give them bits and pieces that, as a total picture, is not going to deliver the outcome that you want for them as a healthcare provider, or that they want as a consumer, or the family expects when they come in and entrusting you with their life or the life of their loved ones.
Will the passage of health insurance reform eliminate racial ethnic disparities? What else should be done?
Health, it relates to the human being, and the human being is a mixed of body, mind, and brain, and perceptions, and feelings, and culture, and memories.
And I think here in Michigan, we have such a very diverse state. We have great, large populations of Native Americans, Eastern Indians. We have a growing population of Arab Americans. We have the largest population outside of the Middle East.
What does culture mean? What are the differences between people's culture?
A set of values and assumptions, notions and beliefs that shape the way people from diverse cultures act and think, relate and communicate what they consider right or wrong, good or bad, sacred or profane, important or unimportant.
The United States landscape is changing, and Michigan is no different. Specifically, Southeast Michigan is no different. We service a great Hispanic and Arab-speaking population, and those populations have specific needs.
The healthcare community has a grave concern about how best to understand, relate, and factor in the cultural, but more importantly, the religious needs of patients, particularly around the end-of-life situation.
As we understand that culture, how I define who I am, a big part of that is my culture. And when I come to you for healthcare, if you don't know and don't understand that aspect of me, you really don't have the full picture of who I am.
As far as it comes to health, there's that mistrust. There's a lot of mistrust with natives using healthcare clinics and hospitals that are, you know, provided in the area. there's a mistrust to go in there, like, you know, and that can be, you know, explained through historical trauma or, you know, or even experiences, present experiences.
The native religion, which is almost synonymous with medicine, was outlawed, and we were forbidden to practice these things until just fairly recently.
Some doctors make fun of us, you know, voodoo or devil magic, and different comments we've heard from some of the patients, so they don't choose not to tell them.
The Asian men tend not to go to a doctor because they believe that, you know, if you cry, you're like a woman. It's macho, just like the African American community. I think it's a universal problem.
African American, we were always taught that, you know, what other remedies, home remedies that didn't, that they would normally work. But if they don't work, then just wait and it'll pass, and then you'll be better, and then you can go on the next day and the day after and the day after. That was just a belief that we have.
We don't believe much in prevention. We believe in, okay, if you're sick, then you go to a doctor. If you're not sick, then why go?
It is a blessing for a physician or a primary care doctor to learn, you know, what are the cultural barriers or factors or sensitivities that I need to pay attention to a woman or to a man.
We recognize as we're providing services that the lion's share of our patients didn't go to medical school or nursing school, but often health providers communicate at a level that's so beyond their patient's ability to comprehend. And so then add the issue of language challenge on top of that, and then add medical terminology on top of that. It's amazing that patients actually even get any care at all.
They want to make sure that the doctor they go to understands their cultural needs and traditions and practices.
Cultural competency prompted most likely by many of the immigrant communities that came to the United States. Cultural competency is the ability of any healthcare organization to respond to the cultural variations that are brought in to the healthcare community, and have the ability of that healthcare organization to come up with solutions to respond to these different backgrounds, patient presentations, and provide services that are applicable to that particular population.
And what we're doing here is collecting data on race, language, and religion. And not just collecting data, but collecting self-reported data. So we are asking patients to tell us how they define themselves racially, what language they prefer to speak and be spoken to, and also what is their religious preference.
You know, I have people asking me, you know, well, are you a native, you know, or whatever, just be the way I look, and a lot of people who are native don't look native.
And we're finding a lot of cultural clashes, tension, and maybe perhaps prolonged intervention, which is a costly way of providing services.
I absolutely believe that cultural competency is an effective method for addressing health disparities.
I think the healthcare industry needs to educate itself a lot more as to what's happening with some of the people that are coming.
You think the nature of the beast that we live in, you know, the nature of this system has changed in 500 years? No. The thing that they're doing, the thing they've already done, the genocide and everything, is happening all over the world. It's just what they've accomplished with the Native Americans and everything. They, you know, the defeat is here, is gone, and, you know, even though the fight is still here and willing to fight back and everything, but what they did to the Native population, now they're doing to the rest of the world.
Native people say that one size does not fit all. We have unique populations with unique needs. Spirit and culture woven together is what defines natives differently. Programs must include these parameters if they are to be truly comprehensive and successful in both delivery approach and desired outcomes. If we are to get it beyond simply acknowledging disparities to applying interventions that work for Native people and other minorities, cultural knowledge must be put into action. Educational attainment is linked to improved health outcomes, partly through its effects on adult income, employment, and living conditions.
So my mother didn't get an education, and nobody made, you know, bones about it. So she didn't encourage my sister to go and get a higher education. She said, you need to learn how to cook, be a good wife, and that was the bottom line.
Education is an important predictor of health because it both shapes and reflects so many other factors that affect people's life chances.
We do recognize that education, those that tend to be less educated, are often those that are more at risk for poorer health outcomes.
Studies show a clear correlation between health and learning at all ages, from early childhood through adolescence to adulthood.
Education is obviously a very fundamental kind of thing. It's something that sets in, that's determined fairly early in life, and in the research that we and other people have done, it seems to have important effects all through life in two different kinds of ways. One is it affects your opportunities for good jobs and better incomes and things like that. So it's shaping all the other socioeconomic conditions. And then over and above that, education seems to have some properties in terms of what people learn and know, or how they think about and deal with information and stresses and problems, that also advantages their health.
Education, while we have issues of health literacy, inadequate health literacy in populations, and those will go into a family environment, into a community, and impact access to food, jobs, housing. So that does impact health disparities in the long run.
We are products of our environment.
Detroit is one of the most depressed areas for education in the country. That means that people didn't graduate from school or left school early, more here than in almost any other city in the United States, okay? So that we have a lower grade of education, which means that we have parents that can't even educate their children or help them with their schoolwork.
Education is essential to advancement. Unfortunately, many farm workers reported difficulties in enrolling their children in school due either to their own immigration status or that of their children. All school-aged children residing in Michigan are entitled to a free public education regardless of their immigration status or that of their parents.
There wasn't a lot of strong motivation and support for them. Another thing was that, you know, a lot of them didn't have their parents right there saying, okay, why are you getting an F in this class? Why aren't you getting your required courses? And since there wasn't really any parent representing them, going to the school and saying, hey, if you're not gonna give my child the proper education that he needs, then I'm gonna go to your superintendent. I'm gonna go to the Board of Education. I'm gonna make a change.
Educational resources and opportunities in the U.S. are distributed unequally, reflecting large patterns of racial and class inequities. Differences in school quality, for example, are due in part to deep patterns of residential segregation and differences in school funding.
Other races, I would say they had a better chance, a better start, because they were in a better position. Start out with?
Well, Bangor is a small town, and so, you know, it's not the best in academics or even sports, really, but you don't get much funding. You know, none of my counselors or teachers or anybody really pushed me, other than the typical, you know, go to community college and call it a day. But
when you have no one to push you and to make things seem, to make you feel like things will be better if you do these, go to school, get education, do all the things that you need to do to make yourself better. And if you don't have anybody kind of pushing you, then it makes it kind of hard.
I say that politicians have done everything to degrade the education rather than increase the education.
If you have an area where the school system might be poor, are certainly of low quality, if you have high rates of dropout and so forth, the likelihood that those folks are going to be able to translate their education, regardless of sort of the level of success in those institutions, into higher education tends to be more challenged than those who have a lot more access to a broader range of resources and so forth.
By foregrounding the life and death consequences of educational inequities, perhaps we can find the commitment to create policies that invest in our schools and help forge a long, productive future for all our children.
Immigrants come from countries where they might not have gotten a very good education, they may not have gotten very far along in the educational process, and so if they come as children, in particular, those are the ones that are dropping out at the highest rates. And then you've got the native-born basically dropping out at a lower rate than them.
I guess they call us like high-risk students. They expect us to be here for like a year and then drop out.
Most of my friends that I had that were in my similar situation that I was, some of the typical things they would tell me was that their parents would tell them, you know, if you're not doing good in school, then drop out. Because the parents thought that, you know, if my kid works and he brings more money in, then that's going to help me. So by going to school, you know, they're really not helping me right now.
Here in Michigan, our schools do not know how to work with Latinos. Basically, they don't have the cultural competence to work with them. They continue to work from the perspective that you must change yourself to be able to succeed in our institutions.
Making sure that people have access to high quality education, high quality resources, and making sure that those, because those do have a major effect on people's opportunities to be successful in higher education, be successful in the job market.
But my sister said, no, I'm going to go to school, I'm going to get an education. So she really strived for that.
So really the challenge is with the schools. You know, these are public school systems. They're supposed to educate everybody. They're not supposed to work on the basis of these children can't learn, the parents don't care, but we're a good school district. That seems to be the perspective that we find here in Michigan, and really, unless we change that and stop blaming the children for their failures in their school systems, nothing's going to change.
It feels good to still be here and excelling at the same time.
Promising initiatives and ideas to improve our school systems and provide better educational opportunities for everyone abound, but not the commitment to pay for them. We all bear the societal burden of lost productivity, increased disability, higher crime, welfare, and prison costs, not to mention the human cost of crushed hopes, dreams, and health.